call your attention to two passages this evening. Mark 15 and the 21st verse, and Romans 16 and the 13th verses. And I would ask those who are physically able, if you would stand in reverence to the reading of the word. Mark 15:21, and they compelled one Simon, a Cyrenian, who passed by, coming out of the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to bear his cross. Romans 16 and 13. Salute Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother, and mine. I want to preach from this subject tonight. This has to be more than a moment. You may be seated. This has to be more than a moment. Brothers and sisters, I thought back as we were traveling here, I thought back to several years ago. On one February day, a 17-year-old boy named Trayvon Martin was murdered in Sanford, Florida. The death of an unarmed black boy at the hands of an overzealous white male who profiled him simply because of the color of his skin raised the righteous indignation of a nation and thrust into the forefront the sin of racism and the scourge of gun violence. I love the fact that within days of this revolting murder, thousands of unlikely individuals put on their hoodies, took pictures and shared them through social media. Preachers took to their pulpits wearing hoodies and preached messages that denounced racial profiling and gun violence, and thousands marched across the length and the breadth of America to declare that we were tired of seeing our young men killed simply because they were black. It was, to be sure, an unprecedented show of national solidarity. But let me suggest to you that the wearing of hoodies alone could not overturn the vicious stand-your-ground laws that have proliferated throughout the United States in the last few years. The hoodie was simply a meme, but it was not a moment. It was not a movement. The wearing of hoodies to symbolize our indignation was just a moment in time that would bring attention, but it would not bring any lasting change. Only sustained pressure and organizing could bring about the change we wanted to see. And I fear that much like the world, the church has specialized in memes and moments and has lacked the spiritual fortitude to create a modern day movement that will compel a new generation to sustain holiness in a world that has lost its moral compass. If used well, memes and moments can be powerful sparks, but used poorly, they simply fizzle out, leaving those impacted with a momentary good feeling, a momentary spiritual high, but not much else. So we've produced spiritual junkies who come to church simply for another hit, another drag, another toke from the crack pipe of praise and worship, from the blunt of shouting and dancing. But when they come down off their high, they still don't know how to live holy. They still don't know how to treat their spouses, how to manage their money. They can out-sing you. They can out-dance you. They can out-war cry you, but their credit is jacked up. Their marriages are falling apart. Their homes are in disarray, and you can't hashtag your way out of your mess. You can't post your way out. You cannot Instagram your way out. You need more than a meme and more than a moment. And how many people do we know that start out on fire? They start pumped up and seem to be determined to live in victory, only to be smacked down by the cares and the vicissitudes of life, only to recede back into their modus operandi and for their drive and their determination to simply fizzle out. History is filled with examples of people who started out humbly and through a sense of destiny leaned and depended on God and rose to great accomplishment, yet came to the end of their lives in utter humiliation. We've got athletes who were at the top of their sports arena only to wind up bankrupt or in prison. Entertainers who won awards and the admiration of millions of people only to die in shame and in disgrace. Preachers who were revered only to fall from grace and to bring reproach upon the body of Christ. We've even seen it on the pages of sacred scripture. David rose to be king and a man after God's own heart, yet his family fell apart and his kingdom eventually split under the rule of his son. Moses was God's meek prophet who led them out of slavery only to stop short of the promised land because of his own disobedience. Samson was a Nazarite from birth and was dedicated to the service of the Lord, yet found himself mocked and shamed by his enemies because he broke his Nazarite vows. And here in our scripture text in Luke, we see another example. We see Jesus, this son of a carpenter, educated in Nazareth, one who gained favor with men, one who was cheered and praised just this past Palm Sunday, but who would soon be mocked and scorned and cast aside by the same folk who did the cheering. You remember on that Palm Sunday when Jesus approached Jerusalem, there were several things that he was aware of. He knew the condition surrounding the people, and he knew the condition of the people's heart. The Jews found themselves under heavy Roman oppression. They were heavily taxed, and there were restrictions and numerous executions by means of crucifixion. And Jesus knew all about those things, but he also knew what was in their hearts. They were searching for somebody. They wanted a king, a conqueror, somebody who was going to set them free. They had seen the mighty works of this man, Jesus. They were witnesses to him restoring sight to the blind. They saw evidence of him healing lame folk. They saw him feed the multitude with a schoolboy's lunch and had leftovers to spare. They heard about him raising Lazarus from the dead. They listened to him teach with authority. And surely somebody with the power and authority that Jesus had was the one that was going to set them free. So Jesus came to Jerusalem and the crowd began to cheer. The timing was right. It was approaching the Passover feast. That was symbolic of the event where the death angel passed over Egypt and God's children were let go. And now, just maybe, Jesus would somehow lead them from the restraint and the cruel treatment they received from the Roman government. But if we fast forward and let the text testify, we find that once the people yelling Hosanna realized that things weren't quite how they thought they were going to go. They turned on Jesus and said, crucify him, only 5 days later. But then we move to Mark 15, and Jesus has been sentenced to die 5 days after Palm Sunday. Those who spoke in tongues on Sunday were cursing by Friday. They did not have the spiritual stamina. They did not have the mental capacity. They did not have the emotional maturity or the fortitude to go all the way with Jesus. But here we find a man named Simon of Cyrene. And the text says that they compelled him who was passing by to carry the cross. But the writer makes note of Simon and tells us that he was the father of Alexander and the father of Rufus. The name of Simon of Cyrene, a North African who, according to the synoptic gospels, bore the cross for Jesus when our Lord was weary from his long night ordeal of being mocked and spit on and beaten and was on his way to Calvary. And here we have Simon carrying the cross. And one could almost conclude that after the cross-bearing experience, that Simon may have simply dropped out of the life of the Christian church. The small reference in Mark's gospel and a greeting in Paul's letter to the Romans, however, indicates that such was not the case. Simon of Cyrene evidently had more than just a momentary experience of cross-bearing for Jesus. Mark introduced Simon of Cyrene by saying they compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country. Here he was, the father of Alexander, the father of Rufus, and the names of Alexander and Rufus would be known by members of the early church only if they had been active in the life of the church. So Mark, the earliest of the Gospels, was written 30 to 40 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. And evidently, the sons of this North African Simon of Cyrene were so active that Mark could mention their names a mere 30 years after the death of Christ, assuming that the entire community of faith would recognize who he was talking about. If Alexander and Rufus were active, were their parents perhaps active? Paul answers that question in Romans 16 when he sends the personal greeting to the members of the church at Rome. And in verse 13, he says, greet Rufus, chosen of the Lord, and greet his mama, who was also a mama to me. Note that Paul calls Rufus chosen in the Lord. And see, Paul didn't just throw around compliments willy-nilly. Rufus had to have been a very special believer to receive that kind of compliment from Paul. And note what he calls Rufus's mother, the wife of Simon, a mama to me also. The church at Rome was a major congregation in the life of the early church. Its location made it pivotal. And apparently one of the leading families in this church was the family of a North African family whose father 30 years before had helped Jesus carry his cross. When Simon reached Calvary, he must not have walked away. He must have become such a believer that 30 years later, his sons and his widows had become ardent believers and famous Christians in the church. Now, I don't know at what point Simon began to take an active interest and a close look at Jesus. Perhaps a curiosity was sparked when he was carrying the cross. Maybe he noticed Jesus' peacefulness
on his way to Calvary. He wasn't acting like the average criminal who had been sentenced to death. He didn't curse back at the people. He didn't spit back at the crowd. But Jesus was calm as if he knew something that they didn't know. He was acting like he could see beyond his present circumstance and see the victory somewhere down the road. He was there watching Jesus on his way to Calvary. And as he's watching Jesus on his way to Calvary, he's looking and he's seeing all of these men that are dressed up in their religious regalia, in their robes. And he watches them cursing and spitting. And he's probably wondering within himself, what could Jesus have done to make these holy men act like they're acting right now? And I believe, my sisters and brothers, that sometime folk in the world are wondering, oh, Lord have mercy. What is it that could have these sanctified folk who shout and dance in church and who speak in tongues in church cuss me out in traffic? What could cause the sisters that sing Zion songs in the choir and on the praise team drop it like it's hot in the club on Saturday night? Oh, you must understand that something sparked his attention on the way to Calvary by watching Jesus. And I wonder today what would happen if folk had to watch us. Notice, if you will, Simon is following Jesus, and the sweat is coming down his face and probably blinding him, and he's walking behind Jesus and he's saying, I'm just going to follow the footsteps of the man that's in front of me. And if I follow the footsteps of the man that's in front of me, eventually I'll get to Calvary. And I wonder what would happen if folk had to follow the footsteps of those of us that are saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost. Would we lead them to the cross, or would we lead them to the club? Maybe Simon's interest was piqued while he was following Jesus to the cross. And then maybe perhaps he just noticed how Jesus was carrying himself. He watched Jesus. And if when he reached Calvary, he stayed around for a while, I'm sure he would have been deeply moved, because he would have heard Jesus pray for his enemies and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He would have seen Jesus tell a dying thief, today you'll be with me in paradise. He would have observed Jesus caring for his mother. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. He would have seen Jesus in his utter loneliness say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He would have seen Jesus's humanity when Jesus said, I am thirsty. He would have learned how to pray when Jesus declared, it is finished. And then he would have seen Jesus shout triumphantly and say, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. He would have seen a hardened Roman centurion on crucifixion duty be moved to confess that surely this had to be the Son of God. If Simon had stayed around, he couldn't have helped but be moved by everything he saw and everything that he heard. And sisters and brothers, when I think about all that Jesus went through for me, I don't know about you, but I'm always moved. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my very soul cries, hallelujah, thank God for saving me. I don't know when Bishop Simon's interest was piqued to be involved with this young pack of rebels that came to be known as Christians. But maybe it started when he began to carry the cross and continued at Calvary. And after the Lord's resurrection and before his ascension. Because he would have seen firsthand what God can still do when the devil has done everything to break your spirit. And even when you have the marks of Calvary upon you, you still have resurrection glory. You still have answered prayer glory. You still have victory anyhow glory. When you've helped someone carry a cross, when you watch that person suffer, when you know for a fact that that person should be over and done with, and yet they stand before you with a testimony that says, look where the Lord have brought me from. I don't know. Maybe Simon was in the upper room or in the crowd that gathered outside on the day of Pentecost. Maybe he heard Peter say, these men are not drunk as ye suppose. But this is that was spoken by the prophet Joel, that in the last days I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Maybe Simon heard the questions, brothers, what should we do? And if he had, he would have heard the answer, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus. Perhaps he was there and he saw what had happened after Jesus rose from the dead and saw Jesus on the Emmaus Road dealing with his disciples. Perhaps he was there in that room when Jesus walked through the door, even though the door was shut. Maybe he was there when Jesus stepped on a cloudy elevator and began to ascend back into glory, and somebody had to say unto them, why stand ye there gazing into heaven? For this same Jesus that you see going, you've got to know that he's coming back. I don't know when Simon became a believer, but I do know that his time with Jesus and his experience of Jesus had to be more than just a moment. And I fear that the church today is just like the church on Palm Sunday. It's just a moment. Just a time to get my praise on. Just a time to get my shout on, and just a moment for me to get this spiritual high. But my sisters and my brothers, this thing has got to be more than a moment. You see, Simon had some other experiences that may not have made it into the record, but whatever happened to Simon on that fateful day, what we do know is that Simon became a believer. What we do know is Simon raised his family in the church. Come on here, somebody. They have something they teach us in seminary called redaction criticism. That's when you don't see something in the text, but you can infer it from the text as long as it doesn't do damage to the text. And so as I look at this particular particular text, Simon must have said, Rufus, Alexander, get up, boy. It's time to go to Sunday school. I don't care if you don't feel like going. Get on up there and sing in the Sunshine Band. Come here, Rufus. Come here, Alexander. It's time to go to YPWW. I know you don't want to be at prayer meeting, but get on your knees anyhow. Come on here, Rufus. Come on here, Alexander. It's time to go to Bible Band. Come on here, boy. I don't care that you're grown. You're still living in my house. And as long as you're living in my house, you're going to get your rusty self up. If you can party all night long, you can praise my God all Sunday morning. Simon raised his family in the church. Here they were, demonstrating that this just wasn't some fleeting moment in their life. Sisters and brothers, we've got to get past just going from conference to conference. When the world all around us is going to hell in a handbasket, when people in our own family are dying without knowing the Lord in their life, when folk who live in our house, I don't care if you don't want to hear it, you're going to hear about Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noonday, Jesus in the midnight hour, Jesus every single where you go. Gotta be more than a moment. There's a deeper and a higher place that we've got to reach as the body of Christ. But we've got to go all the way with Jesus. And here's the thing I like about Simon. Simon didn't just drop him off at Calvary and say, I'm going to see you later, Jesus. Now, I got to get back to what I was doing before they compelled me to carry a cross. We've got to go all the way with Jesus. Tap somebody and tell them all the way, all the way, all the way. You see, when you go all the way with Jesus, there's more in store for you. There are more promises to be kept, more power to be received. There are more battles to be fought, more victories to be won. There's a deeper and a higher place to be reached, but we've got to go all the way. There was a rich young ruler who had a great moment with Jesus, but he didn't go all the way and walked away sad. Pilate had a great conversation with Jesus, but he didn't go all the way and ended up turning Jesus over to a bloodthirsty mob. Judas had great times with Jesus, but he didn't go all the way and ended up betraying the Lord. But John went all the way. And John could testify, beloved, we are all God's children. Paul went all the way and could say, I've fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. I have finished my course. Peter went all the way and could testify, you know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors. But I am bought by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Sisters and brothers, this is more than a moment. I don't know about you, but I plan on going all the way with Jesus. Is there anybody else in here who wants to go all the way? Here we are on Tuesday, but don't get caught up on Tuesday, because Friday is coming. And part of the reason why we don't go all the way is because people stand on the landscape of Tuesday and all they see is the cross on Friday, so they don't go all the way. But you've got to understand that after Friday comes a Sunday, and a resurrection comes on a Sunday. And I came to tell somebody tonight that you might see a bleak hour in front of you. You might see hard times in front of you, but if you determine in your mind that you are going to go all the way, I came to testify and tell you that Jesus will bring you through. And so we fight failure with another try. We fight mountains by climbing the mountains. We fight difficulties with our endurance. We fight delays with our patience. We fight enemies with our class. We fight lies with the truth. But we don't roll over and play dead or turn our head back or throw pity parties or allow the devil to trick us. But we go all the way. Bless his name. And Joshua lets us know that when we go all the way, he said we don't have to go by ourselves. For he said the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Jesus is our captain. The Holy Ghost is our energizer. I want you to know that his anger endureth but a moment. In his favor there is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but tap your neighbor and tell your neighbor joy is coming in the morning. I want to let you know that God is yet on your side. His power defends you. His faithfulness abides with you. His holiness washes you. His justice satisfies you. His kindness keeps you. His mercy holds you. His word hides you. His love enfolds you. His angels guard you. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. I've been sick, but God brought me. Been in trouble, but God brought me. I've been friendless, but God brought me. I've been lonely, but God brought me. I came just to tell you to hold on and don't let it be a moment, but let it be a movement. And God will move you to your place of glory. God will move you to your place of healing. God will move you to your place of victory. God will. Yes, you will. Do I have a witness in the building that don't mind testifying to your neighbor? Lean over at your neighbor and say, neighbor, neighbor, look at me now. If you had seen me 3 years ago, 5 years ago, if you had seen me a little while ago, you'd shout for me right now, because the devil thought I was gonna give up, but I held on, and God picked me up. God turned me around. God placed my feet on solid ground, and here I am with a song in my mouth, with a dance in my legs, running in my feet, clapping in my hands. Yeah! Bless his name. This is not a one-night stand. Tap your neighbor, tell him this ain't a one-night stand. Tell him this ain't no one-night stand. Bless his name. But this is for the long haul. Lord have mercy. When I married this girl, I gave her a vow. I said, for richer, for poorer, in sickness, in health, till death do us part. It wasn't a moment, it's been a movement. And for 25 years, we moved through the heartache.
you thought that you were all alone. But I heard, Lord have mercy, I heard the songwriter say, I've seen the lightning flash, I've heard the thunder roll, I felt some breakers dashing, trying to conquer my soul, but I heard the voice of Jesus saying, still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never alone. Tap your neighbor and say, no, never alone, no, never alone. He's with you in your midnight. He's with you in your heartache. He's with you in your rough time. He's with you Monday through Sunday. Spring, summer, and fall. He's with you every step of the way, even in the dark times. I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. Winter's cold outside. I got the month of May. I guess you say, what can make me feel this way? Tap your neighbor and say, my God, he lifts me when I'm down. He comforts me when I'm broken. He turns me when I'm going the wrong way. He helps me when I can't help myself. He keeps me company when they left me and walk away from me. Lord have mercy. God is there. Yes, he is. And he'll be there always. Say it.
No, no, this ain't a moment. This not just some sporadic happenstance, one night stand. I might call you back tomorrow. No, 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 this ain't one of those. This is till death do us part. Be thou faithful unto death. Help me in here. Look at somebody and say, it's got to be more than a moment. Got to be more than a moment. God is looking for those who are not convenient Christians. For those who don't wait for the convenient moment to acknowledge who he is in your life. Wonder Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. This has got to be more than something I fit in. It's got to be more than something that I might be able to put on my schedule or my agenda. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. And I fear what has happened to the church is we become a church full of convenient worshipers. We'll deal with the Lord when it's convenient. Y'all had a prayer conference last week, and thank God that folk came to prayer. You see, I hope I don't step out of bounds, Bishop. Prayer is the foreplay. I know some of y'all too deep. See, we want to get straight to this. We want to go in right away. Sisters, y'all ought to help me here. Prayer is the box of chocolates and the flowers and the notes. It's that intimate conversation. Come on, y'all ain't getting this. It's that stuff that really starts the party off. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. If I start texting my wife early in the morning, throw a couple phone calls in there, by the time I get home, it's on and popping. Y'all ain't gonna help me in here today. God is not no slam bam, thank you, man. This has got to be more than just a moment of our gratification and satisfaction. Ooh-wee. Preach, child. Preach. God wants to know, are you still gonna love me? Even when I'm not answering the prayer the way you want it answered. You're still gonna be dedicated to me, even when things are not going the way that you want them to go. Even when you pray and I say no. Because sometimes God does say no. Well, Bishop, I've been praying a long time and God just haven't answered me yet. Tap your neighbor and say, yes, he did. He said no. See, she got to love me even when I say no. Y'all ain't getting this. Baby, can you put some money in my account for this? No, not right now. Still got to love me. Our relationship with God is not based on our wants and our whims, what we want, when we want it, how we want it. It's got to be more than just a moment of excitement. And maybe tonight somebody has lost that level of intimacy with God that you once had. It just doesn't feel like it used to feel. And the Lord is saying, I want to rekindle that relationship with you. I want to take you back to that place where you were excited. I want to take you back to that place where you used to testify of my goodness. Where you used to tell people about the goodness of the Lord. I want to take you back to that place. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Let me remix that using modern day colloquialism. David said, I got happy when they said, let's go to church. Not that I was at church. I just got happy when somebody said, hey, you want to go to church? I'm wondering how we sit up in church. Perhaps tonight, somebody needs to run to this altar and say, Bishop, pray with me because I want that spark in my relationship with God again. I want to go back to that place where he meant everything to me. He was my all in all. He was my everything. Where I couldn't go a day without talking to him, without being in his presence.